I am Lynette Swanson. I am the retired extension agent from the city of Norfolk. Before that, I was the extension agent from the city of Chesapeake. And before that, where I really cut my teeth in pesticides was with the city of Hampton. And I wasn't with extension then. I started out as a pesticide applicator and then took the process all the way up to where I was the person who educated the pesticide applicators as well as managed a third of the city's grounds. What I discovered in that whole process was that it's a learning process, and a lot of people don't take the time to figure out what they're doing with what they're handling. So I've pretty much gone pesticide free at my house because I figure for 16 and a half years, I handled it all the time, every day, including inspecting people's storage units. So what you're gonna get tonight is some homeowner ideas for cleaning products as well as for pesticide products. This is why I use homemade remedies in my house and around my house. I have 7 tropical parrots. Most of them fosters or rehomed parrots, which is a parrot that somebody got a parrot and it was a pretty parrot and then it sounded like a parrot and they didn't want it anymore. Or like the little gray guy, he gets into stuff and he doesn't talk. And he's an African gray that doesn't talk. So they didn't want him. Also, I have a garden. I'm big on gardening. And I like to grow flowers as well as caterpillars and butterflies. Very time consuming, but if you put pesticides down, you start having problems raising them. So I don't do that anymore. And I rely on guys like this little lady beetle here. And trust me, this year, my milkweed looked just like that with aphids. And I had lady beetles and I had box elder bugs. I had them all on there eating the aphids and they still couldn't keep up. And last but not least, and this just happened recently, I am fostering a cat. Yes, a woman with 7 parrots is now fostering a cat. So, and she's sweet as she can be, but I have to be careful too because I don't want her to be exposed to things that might hurt her. So we all have our reasons. The baby's there because that's my newest nephew. He's just there to show off. One of the things we found out, the EPA did a study and found out that chemical levels, because we keep our houses so airtight now, we're saving energy. So we've got them sealed tighter than a drum. EPA found that we have chemical levels 70% higher. And that's just not the chemicals that we're using. I'm trying not to move too much. It's not just the chemicals we use in our houses, like the stuff we clean our floors with, the stuff we clean our bathrooms with. It's also the wallboard, the flooring, the formaldehyde in the carpeting or in the upholstery. These are the things we're exposed to. And that a study that they did on women who worked and versus women who didn't work, well, the women who worked had less of a chance of cancer than the ones who stay home. Your home environment is because you're using all these products inside it as well as the building itself. And homes are built differently than most industrial buildings. Every industrial building I worked at was a cubicle, had a lot of airflow. We've had tiny little cloth walls in between us, as opposed to my house has wallboard, insulation, and siding. And my floors are board, It used to be carpet. I took it all out and put in wood flooring. But when I had carpet, every time I vacuumed, I was stirring up what the carpet was made of. Every time I cleaned the sofa, I was stirring up what it was made of. So that's just a 54% chance. And it's what we are exposed to. Toxic cleaning products, and you can add pesticides to this, the stuff you use, that we use in our yards, because, you know, we like nice yards. But they have actually found several of them cause cancer, ADD, Alzheimer's, chronic fatigue, allergies, and asthma. I'll be the first to admit that 16 and a half years, I have asthma and allergies. And I'm pretty sure it's 16 and a half years of working and inspecting pesticide storage units, where if you could smell it, you were exposed. Fibromyalgia, other ailments, multiple sclerosis. All these things are on the increase. And the sad thing is, a lot of them are on the increase in children. So we're exposing children and elderly are the two most vulnerable sections of our population. And I can say that now because I'm getting on the elderly end. But we don't have the immune systems when we're older or when we're younger to combat this. So you got to know what's environmentally friendly in your house and what you can't control. Not everybody can rip out the carpet. I had a good excuse, so I ripped it out. But not everybody can, so you have to work with what you've got. You've got to work with natural cleaners that whenever you can. And I will be the first to admit that there are certain times that I really just don't want to use a natural cleaner to clean the oven. I'd rather not scrub that hard. But there are ways to clean it. And pest management around the house, around the yard, and in the lawn area, I like to use as many natural things as I can, create barriers for the pests, get rid of them when they're overwintering, take care of the problems before they happen. But, for example, I got organic milkweed. Organic milkweed has no defense against aphids, and aphids are great. Things you can do around the house. You can change the way you do the laundry. You can change your, you have recipes for kitchen cleaners here. You have recipes for general cleaners. The ovens, the microwave is a cakewalk. It's the big oven that I have issues with, and I usually don't get to it until I really have to scrub. General housekeeping, sweeping, vacuuming, that kind of thing, and pest control assistance. Stuff you can use. How many of you know what soap nuts are? Soap nuts are actually a berry, not a nut. These came out of my washer today and dried. This is how I do my laundry. I put two bags of soap nuts in one of these little baggies. And that's the soap for my laundry. It does not foam up. So if you're looking for foam, you're not going to get it with soap nuts. But soap nuts will get your stuff clean. I'll pass this around so everybody can get a good look at soap nuts. I had to order them online. I could not find them locally. After I got them online, that's the ones I got online. And I found a business that sold them locally, but they were not as nice as those. You do not want soap nuts that are opened or half-shelled or have the berries in them, because the berries will stay in your clothes. So you want clean soap nuts. But this is what they look like after they've been through the washer a couple times. They get a little beat up.
So when they start looking ragged, you change
them
out?
Then I'll change them out. I usually change out the bags. I put them on because this container has two sides, I'll put one on each side and I change them every other time. Another item that works really good is white vinegar. White vinegar, you can pre-soak your dirty clothes in white vinegar. You can clean your countertops with white vinegar. You can clean your stove. You can, if you have an ant problem, you can use white vinegar and it gets rid of the trace so they can't follow the trail. It's just, it's like a miracle plant. I soak mine overnight. You can also soak them
straight
in
vinegar or vinegar water mix?
It's a vinegar water mix. You can also soak them in borax if you can find it. This is hard to find. You can also soak them in baking soda. But baking soda, if it's a dark color, will fade it. So, and vinegar will not. Vinegar holds the color. Another disinfectant that's really good is cinnamon. I use cinnamon in my kitchen. And my kitchen always smells like I've been baking something. I use it to disinfect the trash can. I use it to disinfect the countertops and the stove. And again, this is cinnamon oil. I grew up with scrubbing sponges and stuff that had like SOS on one side or bristle on one side and then soft on the other. And then they moved to the Teflon on one side and the soft on the other because our pots were Teflon. Oh, by the way, Teflon is not safe for you either. I now get microfiber. Microfiber, if you feel it, I'm going to pass two microfiber cloths around so you can feel them. If you feel it, you will see, you will feel actually, you won't see, but that it's got a texture to it. It grips and it scrubs, but it doesn't scratch and it's easy to keep clean. However, I have seen lots of these things advertised as not gunking up with cheese or the sticky stuff that you have to get off your dishes, and I have yet to find one that doesn't. But I also wash them in the washing machine to clean them, and they come clean. Borax works if you have a stubborn stain. A really good example is that African gray parrot. If you didn't know anything about, well, if you knew anything about parrots, you'd know that African grays can look at you and not let you know that they're gonna bite you. And my husband is constantly being bit by this African gray parrot. It's his parrot. But borax scrubbed into the fabric will take the blood stain out. It will also take out the dirt from gardening.
So do you make a paste out of it?
I make a paste out of it. And again, I use the borax because the baking soda, if it's a dark material, lightens it. If it's borax, it won't lighten a dark material. They both work great on white material. And I use both in my laundry, both baking soda and borax, when I can find the borax. Like I said, it's hard to find. I'm always using the vinegar. For disinfectant, cinnamon oil, I can add that to my cleaner. I like that in my kitchen. In the bathrooms, I use the lemon oil. It just changes the scent. And the microfiber cloths just help me scrub. And then the nice thing about them is they dry really quickly. And you can also wipe down with one to dry. And it's not like using a whole roll of paper towels. No matter how much they say the paper towel is supposed to absorb, just like a cloth. I used to use almost a whole roll cleaning up after the birds. And until you've cleaned 7 parrot cages and 4 play stands for these big parrots, you find a way to do it faster and easier. Kitchen dishes. I hardly ever hand wash dishes anymore. But when you do, you can use a mild dishwashing soap. I have to confess here. I like Ivory and I like the 7th generation stuff. I use Dawn. Dawn has a little bit of petroleum in it. That came out when they were washing the birds. They found out when they were washing all those birds that the reason the Dawn was taking the petroleum off the birds was because the petroleum in the Dawn. And I never know when I'm going to have a parrot land in the sink. But usually it's when I have a full sink of water. So I use that because I know it's safe with them. These work just as well. You can also use them to mix up regular cleaners. Don't think that you have to use that just strictly for dishes. It'll work for other cleaners. And if you're really adventurous and you don't mind not seeing any suds, soap nuts work on your dishes too. You just make a sink full of soap nut water and scrub your dishes with it. You won't see any suds, but your dishes will come clean. In the automatic dishwasher, I use usually vinegar and sometimes borax, but mine tends, the model that I've got tends to clog up if I use a powder, and it cleans fine if I just use vinegar by itself. But you can mix borax and baking soda, or you can use a commercial mix, and they do make environmentally friendly commercial mixes, and vinegar. And the reason you're adding the vinegar is to get the spots off your dishes, because they took the phosphates out. We all have spots on our dishes now. Everybody knows we did them in the dishwasher. If you're mixing baking soda and vinegar, you're gonna have a real interesting experiment in your dishwasher. It tends to foam up. It's good for cleaning sinks and getting rid of drain flies and fruit flies, but it's a bad thing in a washing machine or a dishwasher. Microwaves and ovens. This is how I clean my microwave. I cut up lemons. And I squeeze some of the juice out of them, but I mostly just cut them up. And I put some water in there, and I cook them on high for 5 minutes. And then I let it sit for about 30 or 40 minutes. And when I open it up, it's all steamed up, but the lemon has eaten the dirt off the sides. And all I have to do is take my little microwave, my little microfiber cloth, and wipe. And trust me, my microwave gets a mess. So if this works on mine, it'll work on anybody's. In the oven, I've been wanting to try the lemons. I have not used the lemons yet in the oven. I have used the baking soda and hot water paste. This is a real interesting, it works. It works. It's just real interesting to do because you're down on your knees getting that in the oven and then you leave it overnight. I also heat the oven before I do this, just so that the sides are a little hotter and it pastes a lot, a little faster. And then I scrubbed it out. I did not have to use steel wool pads, and that is a miracle because my oven does not get cleaned until it absolutely desperately needs it. But the rough side of a microfiber sponge took care of it. I have a self-cleaning oven. I do not use it on self-clean because the insides of those ovens are Teflon. Mm-hmm. And so when it gets the temperature that high up, it's releasing a gas. And just like the canary in the coal mine, the first ones out would be the birds. But if it's toxic to them, what's it doing to me? Laminate flooring. Most laminate floorings have like a dozen warnings on them that say, don't do this, and don't do this, and don't do this, and don't do this. You can use olive oil, and you can use red cider vinegar, if you don't mind the smell. Or you can get, there are several non-toxic, pick-friendly laminate cleaners. If you're, you know, it depends on how new your laminate flooring is. Same with wood floor, hardwood flooring. I use the olive oil vinegar. I don't put the vodka in. I think it's a bad mix. I waste the vodka. But the vodka, actually, what it does is it helps it dry faster.
Oh, okay.
Or it makes the job go faster, maybe. Olive oil works great, but you really have to make sure that you wipe, because otherwise people will be sliding. You know, there's all those scenes of people sliding on their socks. It doesn't have to be extra virgin. It doesn't have to be. It can be
cheap?
Store brand cheap. Okay. It does the job. You can also just use store brand cheap cider vinegar. It's just, it's going to give you the cider vinegar smell. Tile, white vinegar works well. So does the baking soda. Baking soda paste makes a nice little scrubby for tile. And I use that on the tile in the bathrooms. Okay, what about your carpet? How many of us didn't put baking soda on the carpet and vacuum it up? I can remember this. I can remember doing this for years. Baking soda on the carpet, let it stay for a while, and then vacuum it up. And that cleaned the carpet and freshened the room. You can also use baking soda and water in a carpet cleaner. Again, I removed all my carpet, so I don't have to do that. Club soda also works great. The bathroom. Everybody loves to clean the bathroom. They can't wait to be the person who has to do that. The general kitchen cleaner works great. I just substitute lemon for cinnamon because that's my personal preference. I'd rather my bathroom smelled like lemon than cinnamon. Doesn't matter. And you can use those pastes to scrub in the tough areas. Yeah. The mirror, you can use straight vinegar water. Glass I use in my bathroom, I use lemon oil and water, but you can use white vinegar and water. I just use lemon because my bathroom is smelling like lemons, bathrooms. And toilet bowl cleaner, you mix borax and water. And basically all I do is take the borax and sprinkle some in there and swish it around with the toilet bowl brush. And I have trained my husband how to do this. And so that's his job. And he likes it because let him use an old-fashioned toilet bowl brush. He hated all those other little like scrubbing bowls and things like that. He didn't like using those, but he likes using the old-fashioned toilet bowl brush. So that's his job and he loves it. And he knows not to let the borax solidify in the bottom. For dusting, I hardly ever dust. But when I do dust, I just use a microfiber cloth. If I think it's bad enough, I'll dampen it. If it's some antique shelves that my great-grandfather made, I'll use olive oil so I don't put water on them and leave them alone. But this will take it off in a heartbeat. It grabs it. And that's the same cloth that went around the room. Just, these are floral. See, you can look more stylish. And your sponges and your cloths can match. But you want to use a soft microfiber for that. And never use these, by the way, on your electronics. They make a different cloth for electronics. These will scratch them up.
The screens?
The screens. You can do the rest of the TV or any of that, but if you do it across the screen, it'll scratch it. And I have an iPad to prove it. Because my husband grabbed one of those cloths that's circulating, thinking it was his cloth that I had gotten him for his iPad. I know lemons are really good. I like lemons. I think they're great disinfectants, and I think cinnamon is not publicized enough for how much disinfectant you can get out of that. I like to really use the oils, but the reason I had that under the sink was that was so much easier to grab and clean with. Whereas these, I have to mix them up. It's kind of like, this is the little soap nuts I passed around. They sell an extract of those little soap nuts. In pest control, you guys are going to get, because I taught it for 16 and a half years, you're going to get the drill. You got to know what you're fighting. If you have a plant, something that has holes in it, he's not there, he's gone. It's done. He's done his damage, he's left. Same with the tomatoes that used to get the spotted wilt virus. The insect that caused the problem and transmitted the virus was long gone by the time you saw it. Now when you saw my plant with the aphids on it, they are there. The plant puts out new green growth, aphids magically appear. You want to set a tolerance. What can you tolerate? I was growing the milkweed for monarch caterpillars. Because I'm growing the milkweed organically for monarch caterpillars, I can't tolerate anything on them other than water. So I was out there spraying aphids off and waiting for the good guys to come in and eat. And I'm also growing them in an area that I don't, you know, it's not that great of a looking plant anyway. So it's not, you know, a focal point in my yard. If it's a focal point in my yard, I might work a little harder on it. Baking soda works really great for fungus problems.
For a rose bush, you could use that?
A baking soda mixed in a spray. Baking soda in a mixed spray on roses works against black spot. Mm-hmm. And what it's doing is it's changing the pH. Mm-hmm. And when it changes the pH on the leaf surface, the black spot fungus no longer finds it a great place to live. Another thing you can do is anytime you have any plant that has an insect pest or even a fungal pest or a bacterial pest and the leaves fall, get rid of those leaves. Because every time we have high humidity, which we have all the time around here, rain, which lately we've been having all the time, that gets enough water in the air, enough moisture in the air to reinfect your plant. So you want to break that cycle. You have to have, for example, a disease, you have to have a plant that's susceptible, the right conditions, and the pest. And we usually always have the pests here. They're hanging around. And if you've seen the disease before on the plant, you're going to see it again because the plant's susceptible. So you've got to make the conditions not perfect. You want to look at, can you get a biological, can you make your lawn and landscape so nice that they want to come help you? And the lady beetles I had this year were lazy. They came and they just kind of hung around. And I thought, I saw maybe one or two egg cases. And I had dozens of them. I mean, one of my neighbors said, "What has happened? You've been infested." But they didn't lay any eggs. And they weren't eating that many aphids either. Then the box elder bugs came. I have box elder bugs. I still have box elder bugs in all generations. So these guys are raising their young on these plants. And that's my biological control. My cultural control is the sanitation, is the getting rid of anything that I've had a problem before. I fixed the strategy. I was surprised by the milkweed, but I have a strategy for my azaleas and my gardenias. I have a strategy for the lawn, which is like ignore it. Although my husband has a thing about dandelions. So I let him pluck them before they go to seed. And I evaluate how well stuff works. For example, even though lady beetles are supposed to be so great and the larva is supposed to eat like 100 times its weight in aphids, they didn't do anything. So they're like, out of here. I'm happy with box elder bugs now. You just evaluate what's working for you and what's not. And if you do need to use it, these lighter soaps like Ivory or this one, or Myers, and there's one that Trader Joe's sells that has like 60 gazillion things all over the label that tells you what it does. They all make a nice, soft, soapy spray. And that soapy spray will kill soft-bodied insects. It will not kill spider mites, and it won't kill some of the hard-coated scales. But a dormant oil will take care of the hard-coated scales. And what I have found with spider mites is that a hosing with water, they don't like to be wet. Inside, you can use borax. That's the old-fashioned barrier for cockroaches and spiders in your house. You can bait it with a sugar solution to make sure that they get the toxic stuff and then take it back. I use a lot of vinegar in my house. But borax was the one that I grew up with, a mother who used borax everywhere. Mild soaps will kill on contact for ants and roaches. They will not kill water bugs. So do not go after the ones that are this big. They will just stand there and look at you and like, okay. But they'll do that if you spray them with Raid too, so. Cayenne pepper works sometimes. Oils work great, because what oils do is shut down the way they can breathe. It coats their body. Outside, I have used borax around the house. I use the mild soaps. I started to say insecticidal soaps because that's what I call them, although you can buy insecticidal soaps, but these work just as well. The hydrogen peroxide is an interesting fungicide too. It does the same thing that baking soda does, and it's easier to mix up. It changes the pH on the plant's leaf, and the fungus doesn't grow. Now the weeds, I don't do a lot of weed control. I do take care of weeds in my driveway and concrete, and I do not use boiling water. It does work, but it's hard to handle. I have a little sprayer that I mix lemon juice and vinegar and spray it. Now the vinegar I use outside for weeds is vinegar you buy labeled for weed control. Because when you use a pesticide, when you're going to do something for a pesticide, it has to be labeled for that. And the best tools, this is not going to be in your notes either, the best tools I have found for scrubbing things, I don't want to be an ad for a certain store that is all, everything is one price, but the tire cleaner is nice and stiff, and it can get narrow spots. And I didn't think about it. It was a friend of mine who gave me one to clean the tires on my car because my car needed cleaning. And I went, oh, I can use this. I also use different kinds of brushes. I haven't used this one yet. I'm waiting to see what it does. This is supposed to be ergonomically correct for scrubbing. But I use a lot of different brushes from that. Everything's the same price store. And the GSE, this is pricey stuff. This little bottle, if I can read it, was $20. This is what I clean the bird cages with now. And the litter box will be cleaned with it. You only mix 1 to 3 drops to a quart. It's grapefruit seed extract. It is a disinfectant and a cleaner. It's great. And it doesn't smell, but you have to swallow a pretty big price when you buy it. And it does come in the really big bottles, but this is as much as I can afford at any given time. And, well, going back to that for a minute, going back to the weeds, I have a nephew who is adamantly going back to the earth. They are renting a farm not far from Rodale. He is like really going back to the earth. And vinegar and lemon juice is all he treats his weeds with. And it works. Epsom salts also works against insect pests. And it's a great bath relaxer. So you can use it to scrub the tub afterwards. You gotta train everybody who takes a bath. Scrub afterwards. Epsom salts. This is the one I was talking about. You can see they've been going to town. There's lots of dead aphids, but there's some few live ones there. That is actually the seed pod for a milkweed. These guys had been eating and eating and eating, and they were doing a number on those aphids. And I did not invite them, they just came. And now they're all over everything. I mean, they're walking on my milkweeds, they're walking on my shrubbery, there, anywhere there's anything they can eat, they're eating it. They're all this, like this one's younger, this one's older. It's probably, these two are probably mating. But I have them in all sizes out there now. From teeny to...
You planted these milkweeds for...
Monarch butterflies. Because monarch butterfly populations were down 45 to 60% this year. I wanted to get here early enough to go to the butterfly house. But they were down that much this year. And the ones that are emerging are, they're losing about a third of them to a virus. That's a whole nother talk. So I planted organic milkweed. But these guys here, these are guys you're looking for. The lacewing, the lady beetle, although I wasn't real that thrilled with them this year. The little white egg cases on that caterpillar there, that is actually a tomato hornworm caterpillar. He is covered with parasitic wasp eggs. These wasps do not sting us, but they do lay their eggs on these caterpillars. But now they don't know the difference between these caterpillars and my zebra swallowtail caterpillars. So they may do that to them too. I've seen them. But they will emerge and they'll eat that caterpillar and he's gone. And your tomato is safe. But these are all natural enemies. I have not had a tomato hornworm, knock on wood, in a long time. But like I said, with the lacewings, I only had like two or three egg cases. They put their eggs on a little stalk. So if you see something on a little white thing on a stalk on the plant, that's what they are. So what you want to do is look for natural products as much as you can. You can make a little kit like this. I've got instructions in there. It's easy to carry around. It's easy to have. I just have them stationed like in the bathroom. I might have this in the kitchen. I've got under the sink. I've got a bucket like that with the stuff in. These essential oils I have all over the house because I may grab a rag, tip this on it, dampen it, tip it, and clean something. I may not too, but I may. And in where my cleaning supplies are for laundry, I have the poor aide, when she first came to my house and saw what I had for cleaning, she's like, what do you wash with? I said, oh, these bags of nuts. And she said, if you have them ready, I'll use them, but I don't understand it. And she's the one who said, you know they don't foam. And I said, yes, I know, they don't foam. Always remember to have vegetative layers if you're planting in plants, because that gives the plant some cushioning for moisture, doesn't stress it. Because when a plant is stressed is when it gets problems. So you want to make sure you keep it unstressed. Also, the beneficials like certain things. And the ones that will tear up your plants, you can actually plant sacrificial plants. And they'll go over there. They like them better. And that's what a lot of organic growers do. They have like two or three rows of plants that the plant likes, that the bug likes better. If you buy beneficial insects, there are rules for releasing them. Lady beetles, you have to dampen the foliage and release them in the evening in the dark or they'll fly away. You have to give them a chance to get used to where they're at. I used to live next to a guy, he's moved now, but he would buy walking sticks, praying mantises, and he'd move them. He'd be out there moving them from plant to plant on a Saturday. And one of them got over and ate some frogs at my house. And I took it back home. And I said, you know, Phil, it was eating my frogs. And my frogs eat things. So I was like, I'd rather have the frogs. I know people don't like to see snakes in their garden. But snakes are a good thing if they're not poisonous. They keep down a lot of pests. I know we don't like to see them. We like them to be there working in the fringes, outer fringes, but not where we're at. I always make a lot of noise when I go into the big bushy garden areas because they'll leave if I make a lot of noise. I attract birds. They do eat insect pests. They also eat my blueberries. They also eat some other, you know, if it's a hot, dry summer, they're going to hit the tomatoes for moisture. I know that. But they also eat bugs. So it's a trade-off. I just cut those parts out. And these are the guys that, well, with the exception of maybe that praying mantis. He's borderline right now. But these guys do take care of problems. This is the wasp, the little wasp, and that's much magnified. He's not nearly that big. The wasps that take care of pests will not sting us. But you will know, there are several that do different things, but you will know if a caterpillar's been hit with a wasp because they'll either have the eggs on them or they'll be bent over because it kills them. Spiders are good. They are good. Now, I do not go as far as a friend of mine who rehomes black widow spiders because she doesn't believe you should kill any spider. But spiders, for the most part, are good. I just watch out for the ones that I know are bad. And these are some more. Nematodes that you'll never see, but they're in the soil. And there are good nematodes eating the bad nematodes. There are good spider mites eating the bad spider mites. If you have spider mites and you shake them over on a cloth, the one that runs the fastest is usually a good one. A beneficial spider mite moves really fast, as opposed to a regular spider mite. Mealybugs have pests that look just like them. So they can blend in with the crowd while they eat. But these guys all do beneficial things. You just don't see them because usually they're so tiny or they're on the other side of the leaf or you're not out there looking at them. Typically will have more bad spider mites than beneficial spider mites. There is a spider mite that eats spider mites, and it's red.
Oh, okay.
But it's faster than the others and it doesn't hang out with them. And there are plants that they like over plants that they don't like. For example, you'll never see a juniper in my yard or a spruce because they love them. When we have a hot, dry summer, they turn brown because the spider mites have been eating them. They also like arborvitae. But anyway, those are the good guys. You hardly ever see them, especially not the little wasps. Okay, your pets. There's all kinds of things. Now it's become so popular to be eco-friendly with your pet that you can find things now on the market that are eco-friendly. You can use soap nuts in water to wash your dog or cat, if you're up to fighting a cat. Baking soda and cornmeal works as a dry shampoo if they don't like water. Actually, baking soda and cornmeal meal works for a great dry shampoo for us. They use it a lot in hospitals. You can wash the bedding with soap nuts and hot water. You can use biodegradable training pads, or what I used when I had dogs, I used reusable pads that they make for people, because they're bigger and they're more absorbent. And you just take them outside, hose them off, put them in the wash them, dry them, and they're done. And you can use them again. Much easier. There are non-toxic litter products now for cats. Baking soda in the litter box, that was an old standby. I grew up with cats. And it was always put the baking soda in and mix it in real good with the clay litter. Avoid the tea tree oil. It is toxic to them. If you have a pet area that needs scrubbing, For example, I had a dog that, she was a golden retriever, and she was the sweetest dog in the world, but she knew exactly where every air conditioner vent in the house was. And so when she was missing, all we had to do was hunt the vents. And all you had to do was walk in the room. If the room was hot, that was the room she was in. And I would have to scrub around the vents because dog oil from her fur, she'd leave it. She loved air conditioning. She loved heat in the winter too. She was not a good outdoor hunting dog. In fact, she didn't like hunting at all, but she loved inside. She was a domestic dog. But mixing that paste and scrubbing took care of those marks that she left behind. They also, cats will leave marks on your wall when they rub. Dogs will do it too, because they'll rub, and you can get them off with that stuff. They make recyclable chew toys now that you buy the toy, you keep the information, and when the dog chews it up, you send the parts back to the company, and they remake the toy. Hopefully your pet likes it as much the second time. They make hemp collars instead of plastic collars. In the case of my kitty, she doesn't wear a collar at all. There is a doggy septic tank out there now, so you don't have to pick up the poop. You can just put it in the doggy septic tank. And white vinegar and water for their cages, GSC for their cages, specific for the pet. For example, my cockatoo doesn't like vinegar. She sneezes nonstop. And she's, of course, the featheriest one. So she gets lemon oil in water for her spritzing. And she loves it. Just got to be specific with the plant, with the particular pet. Can't wait to see what the cat wants. Then I gave you, on your handout, resource sites. These are those same resource sites. And I went through and gleaned the ones that had changed. Like Consumer Reports used to have some information. They stay up to date, and of course that's no longer there. But these ones that you have are very up to date and current, as of today, or as of last night when I checked them. DIY Network has a whole bunch on it. Soap Nuts Pro, you would think they're just selling soap nuts, but they tell you everything you can do with soap nuts, how you can mix them, and look how to put them together, and what soap nuts to buy and what soap nuts not to buy. What's a good quality soap nut? And the government does have some good information on using non-toxics. And there's another page of resources. And that is not my cat. That actually sometimes is my Facebook page. I like that cat with the sunglasses on. But those are the sites, and they're on your sheets.